Good morning. Good morning. What's happening, family? Welcome to the show this morning. It is Michelle Bryant. You listening to Say Something Real here at WNOV, 860 AM, 106.5 FM. Want to remind folks, because I always forget, you can check us out on Facebook, 860 AM, WNOV, or on YouTube, WNOV The Voice, and hit the subscribe button. Yes, here we go. Here we go.
Now we're cooking with
people. I see a number of people checking us out. Saw folks on yesterday. Good morning to everybody that follows us on social media. Good morning, Adeline. I saw you hit me up this morning. Good morning to Shelby and to Alex, my mainstays, who always check in. What up, K-Sweezy? How you doing this morning, bruh?
Ooh.
Oh, we getting the lips together.
Man.
We getting luscious for the camera. I mean, what we doing?
Trap, dap.
I'm just saying, you know, I see you. How you doing this morning, bro?
Drained.
Wow, what you do? What's wrong with you? Why are you drained?
Hey, when I say bound by the chains of celebration.
We're not doing that today.
I am. I'm doing it all my life.
We're not doing
Yahoo!
It. What's up, T? Right? We not doing
celebrate good times. Come on,
you know that's from you know that's
we got a celebration. Right?
Carvey was like, "Wait, what? What's that? What's that?"
Oh, yeah,
somebody actually lost the presidential election because they did that. Carvey.
No, they didn't go Yahoo. They went Yeah.
They were Yeehaw.
Yahoo and Yeehaw.
They stock fail after they did that, and they literally lost an election. So I understand you looking up, Carvey.
Yeah.
What up, Mr. Carvey? How you doing this morning, my brother? I'm well. All right, family. So let me just say, went to vote yesterday after I left the show. And first of all, met a listener to the show. Good morning, sis. How you doing this morning? It was a pleasure to meet you. We actually took selfies of clowning at the at the election booth. But the team that is running the Capitol voting center, whatever they call it, location, everybody over there was fabulous. To the brother that's at the door giving you the third degree when you walk in the door. Do you live in the city of Milwaukee? Yes. Are you a registered voter? I am. You know, so you had to answer. I'm like, dude, what's 21 questions? Like, why I'm getting all of this walking in the door? 21 questions. So in any case, he was great. You know, when you get done, after you've had this amazing experience, I'm going to need you to hit up this little barcode and, you know, give us, you know, great scores on the survey. Like, okay. So I go through the whole process. Everything was very easy. You know, you are surprised, I think, at how much how much stuff is actually on the ballot. And that is because you got a bunch of judicial races on the ballot. Only one of which actually has more than one candidate to choose from. All the rest of the judges are not being challenged, as typically they never are. But it's going to be funny because when it's time for Lena to run, because remember her appointment from Governor Evers was only 4 years. So she has to run for office in 2025. Watch how many names. It's going to be so interesting to see how many people try to run against Lena for that judicial seat. But yeah, right now, only one seat is in contention. And that was Rochelle Johnson Bent, I think is that sister's name, and Mayor Sibel Cabrera are running for a judicial appointment. It's presidential preference. So you also, you know, indicate whether you ride with the Dems or the Republicans or independent on the ballot. Another thing that was interesting is because this was not the word that I was most familiar with. Let me see. Let me go pull it up. I meant to, but So, you know, we have seen how a number of early voting cities and communities in their primaries and getting ready for their, in their spring elections, to show their frustration with the Biden administration in relationship to Palestine, and how, you know, there's been this blanket check approach to Israel. People feel like a lot of American money is helping to commit genocide in relationship to innocent Palestinians. The numbers now topping well over 32,000-33,000 people estimated to have been killed as a part of this whole thing. And so there were people on in the States who supported Palestinians, who wanted to see a ceasefire, who wanted to see humanitarian aid being provided to Palestinians, to show and demonstrate their frustration with the president, who they felt could take a stronger stance, position publicly on the whole Palestine situation. People were voting uncommitted. You know, they asked people to go in and to check on their ballots that they were uncommitted. And we saw in some states, you know, those numbers, I think overall, we saw about 250,000 people vote uncommitted in different cities around the country during that period of time. So I had read about it before I went to go vote. I think in a story a day or two ago, this whole piece about getting to the ballot, and I think the word, and I still haven't found it yet. Maybe I'll just pull up a sample ballot. Why don't I do that? But I think the word is unstructured is what I saw on. Hang on. I'm pulling up my ballot so I can make sure I have the right word. Because I know some people will be like, what's this? What is this word, Michelle? And I am coming, you guys. I'm coming. All right, here we go. All right. So the word is uninstructed delegation. So when you go and you get your ballot, the first thing at the top of the ballot says President of the United States, Democratic, and then it lists candidates. Joe Biden's name is on there. Dean Phillips' name is on there, just two people. And then it says uninstructed delegation. When you go below that, President of the United States, Republican, you got Chris Christie's name still appears on our ballot. Vivek Ramaswamy's name is on the ballot. Ron DeSantis, Nikki Haley, Donald Trump, and then uninstructed delegation. There have been people that have been asking folks to check that uninstructed spot on the ballot, again, voicing their frustration with Joe Biden. And somebody said my voice is real low, Keon. I don't know what's up. Okay. But voicing their frustration. Thank you, Dion.
You wasn't yelling this morning.
Oh, was that it?
You had to bring it up.
Low sexy, okay. Hello, key.
There we go.
But yeah, so just so people know, okay, a couple other people said better, thanks. So again, just real quick, when you go, if you have not voted yet, you early vote, or even on election day, top of the ballot, President of the United States, they list the Democratic Party first. Those candidates, Joe Biden, Dean Phillips, I don't even know who Dean Phillips is. And then there is a column you can, oval you can check, uninstructed delegation. Then again, down to president and all of the people whose names were on the ballot. But it's interesting because, well, I guess Tim Scott came out before all of them. Chris Christie, Vivek, Ron DeSantis, Nikki Haley, Donald Trump. Their names make the ballot in Wisconsin. And then they also have an uninstructed delegation. I just don't remember that being a category before. Maybe I wasn't paying attention. I don't know if that's a new way of characterizing that, but I don't remember that. But there is a push underway, even here in Wisconsin, to get people to check uninstructed as a way of voicing frustration over what's happening to Palestinians. You want to say something, Kay?
No, that was what Will Martin was talking about.
On the uninstructed piece?
Yeah.
What did he say?
Well, exactly what you said. My whole thing was, what happens if it wins?
Yeah.
He said it would be a bunch of delegates that would probably, you know, cause chaos because everybody want to be the leader. But it's just to pretty much show frustration and a point. Yeah.
And I mean, and like I said, it's on the Republican side as well. And there are a lot of people that, you know, feel that there will be people in voice of opposition to Donald Trump. I'm not going to vote Democrat, but I don't want to vote for Donald Trump. And so they may end up voting for the uninstructed delegation.
And see, that's where it gets tricky, because even though I said if it won, and we were like, yeah, then you got people that like really don't want Trump but want to vote Republican, and then you got people that's got a problem with
Biden. Yeah. So I mean, but do you get to the point at the end of the day where you get roughly 70 million people doing that? Because that's what kind of numbers you need for people to get in line.
Well, one day we thought Donald Trump would never be president. Well, most people, I kind of always knew it could happen, but never thought Donald Trump would become president. And
but it was a much more realistic chance of him becoming president when you consider that, you know, half of this country is Republican, and most people will stick with the party line, right, no matter who the delegate ends up being, or the nominee ends up being. But it just was one of those things. So if you see that on the ballot, just pay attention. And again, you have a number of judicial races, the Court of Appeals, and then Milwaukee County Circuit Court judges. And again, the only contested race in the judicial races is Circuit Court Branch 43, Rochelle in Johnson Bent, and Mayor Sibel Cabrera. And then everything else is chill until you get down to the Milwaukee County Executive race. Aisha Griffin's name does appear on the ballot, and David Crawley. And they actually did the David C. Crawley because, you know, we had a David Crawley who was going to run against David Crawley. You had to appreciate that moment. And now I'm looking at just my ballots. Some of your ballots will be different depending on which district you live in. But you have the Milwaukee County Comptroller's position on there. Liz Sumner is running, and Michael Harper. Michael Harper is the brother that we've had in the studio. He was with us on Election Central. Talked to him a couple of times and just saw him over at the event last Saturday. So Michael Harper's name is down as Milwaukee County Comptroller. I haven't had any conversation with Liz Sumner. Milwaukee County Supervisor District 18, that's me, Northwest Side, Deanna Alexander, and Brandon Willifort. I'm supposed to be trying to get this brother in the studio, so I will be working on that. For mayor, Cavalier Johnson and David King. Somebody asked about whether or not he really did have a real PhD or earned one. And I went to the website and it said he got it from some Grace Academy or something, and people scoffed at that. So I don't know what's up with the PhD. City Treasurer, Spencer Coggs, no opponent. Comptroller for Milwaukee, City of Milwaukee, Gregory Grotz, and Bill Christensen. Bill Christensen is actually going to be in the studio this morning. So we'll be talking to him about his candidacy for Milwaukee Comptroller. Milwaukee City Attorney, T. Spencer, which I made a lot of hay about the other day on Keith's show, and Evan Goyke, Terriman Spencer. I thought it was interesting that he chose not to spell his name out and only put T. Spencer on the ballot. You do have a choice to list your name however you want to on these ballots for the most part. And I heard that like yard signs or signage just says Spencer. I don't even know if he put the word re-elect on there. It just says Spencer. And a couple people noted that, yeah, if you the incumbent, you definitely gonna say re-elect. So I just think that it is interesting how this whole race is being played right now. And as I said on Keith's show, you don't mess up your own name. You know, when you can't use your own name, because there's a reason why he is not using Terriman. Now, whether it's of his own making or just all the controversy and the drama that went on, one of the things that I've said consistently is that he walked into a bad situation when he got the city attorney's position. Number one, it goes down in history for me as one of the shocks of all times. Like, I don't think that anybody saw Terriman Spencer winning that city attorney's race. It just caught me completely off guard. And there were many that worked in the department and in the division who had worked with Grant Langley for 1,000 years, and they did not want this brother walking through the door. They did not want him. And so they went out of their way to make his life miserable. Let me be clear. I believe that. There were a lot of people who did not want him there, and they were, you know, not fair to him and rude. And, you know, it just was a lot of drama. But what you try to tell people is, okay, so how you respond and how you handle it will dictate how some of this stuff goes. And when you appreciate that, literally, you know, some of the responses were just like, come on, bruh, you're not helping, man. So in any case, city attorney's office, he hasn't reached out to come on the show. So far, I will reach out to Tierman, see if he wants to get on. His opponent, Evan Goyke, is scheduled to be on the show tomorrow. Evan Goyke is a state representative. I worked with him for a number of years in the state capitol. And the one thing about Evan Goyke that will always stand out to me, when he got elected, and I was working for Lena's office, I remember Evan Goyke coming by the office, and he sat down and he talked with me. And one of the things he said to me, he said, Michelle, everything that Senator Taylor has to teach me, I want to learn. You know, I want the benefit of, and it was kind of funny because he actually represented Lena in terms of Lena's interest, because Lena has properties in that district, in his home district. And so, you know, I just never forgot that this young guy hits the door, came to, you know, one of the senior legislators from the Milwaukee area, and was like, hey, you know, whatever I can learn, whatever she got to teach, whatever your office can do to help me in this transition, I'm here for it. And I think about that in contrast to a number of elected officials who have come in, and in some cases Black, who have not wanted to have anything to do with Lena, did not want to hear what Lena had to say, who literally had, you know, listened to white folks in the building and was talking about how to get rid of Lena, and they hadn't been in the building 10 minutes. So it's just funny to me how certain things work. And when people tell you, you know, all your skin folk ain't, or all your, what is it? All your skin folk ain't your kin folk. And I remember, you know, and I just, that's one thing I always, always remembered and appreciated about Evan Goyke, was the idea that I'm here to learn, I'm here to educate. And he goes on to have a very interesting career in the state, as a state representative, ends up being on joint finance like Lena was, ends up, you know, playing a pivotal role in a lot of legislation. And he just ended up having, you know, like a good record. He got bills passed. He was in real leadership roles, not fake leadership roles where you really don't do nothing and you really not moving the needle, your name just down as leadership. He actually was making things happen. And, you know, so it'll be interesting to understand why he wants to run for city attorney, because he's been highly successful as a state representative. So we'll see. So I'll be talking to him tomorrow. I got to take a break and go through quickly the referendums, because I didn't get to do that yesterday except for the MPS referendum. A couple of people have asked about that. And then we will get Mr. Christensen in the studio to talk about his race for Milwaukee Comptroller. Michelle Bryant, y'all, WNOV, 860 AM, 106.5 FM. Be right back. Power.
March is Women's History Month, so we are honoring local Her Story makers. We are shining a light on Angela Mallett. Angela is the owner of Honeybee Sage and Wellness, an apothecary and sober bar. So whether you're looking to unwind or looking for a healthy turn up, Angela's got you covered. Be sure to support her business today.
This moment in women's history was brought to you by U.S. Bank. U.S. Bank has more than 50 locations in the greater Milwaukee area. Visit usbank.com to find a location near you. U.S. Bank, a member of FDIC.
Contact Tax Relief Helpers for details and restrictions.
Attention, anyone that owes money to the IRS. The IRS has restarted aggressive enforcement actions against taxpayers who owe back taxes that were temporarily suspended for COVID. If you owe $10,000 or more, you must hear this because now is the time to clear your IRS tax debt. A special toll-free number has been established so you can stop penalty fees, avoid liens, levies, or other hostile measures by the IRS. Call Tax Relief Helpers right now at 800-681-8471. Tax Relief Helpers will provide you the maximum protection afforded by law.
I got behind on my taxes and owed $48,000. I didn't know what to do. I called and they got my bill lowered to just $3,500.
I owed $87,000 in taxes and it was scary. I got the amount I owed down to just $3,500. I saved $83,500.
If you owe money to the IRS, don't wait another day. Call 800-681-8471 right now before the IRS enforces liens, levies, or other aggressive measures. The call and consult are absolutely free. Call now. Call 800-681-8471. 800-681-8471. 800-681-8471.
For an Allstate agent, providing protection options that fit your life is something that they take well. Personally, Allstate agents are committed to learning about your needs and helping customize protection to meet them. From bundling your home and auto insurance with ease to evaluating optional coverage, your Allstate agent can help build an insurance proposal that fits your life. And just as important as learning what you need is learning what you don't. Because helping you get the coverage you want with the savings you deserve is what Allstate is all about. It's time to get coverage that's catered to you. Are you in good hands? Call Milwaukee Allstate agent Cindy Johnson at 414-445-2558. That's 414-445-2558. Today, for a free quote, home, auto, renters, condo, and more. Cindy, Nancy, and Lyndon can't wait to meet you.
Subject to terms and conditions and availability. Allstate Fire and Casualty Insurance Company and Allstate Property and Casualty Insurance Company and its affiliates, Northbrook, Illinois.
Hey, this is School Board Director Daryl Jackson, who represents District 3 for NPS.
NPS School Board Director Aisha Carr representing District 4.
Tune in this Friday from 7 to 9 a.m. as we discuss
all things NPS referendum and as we talk about the state of emergency in education in the city of Milwaukee.
The Wisconsin Home Energy Assistance Program end of the season is approaching. Don't miss out on benefits and help with your WEED energy bill. Just go to keepwarmmke.org. It's made it easy for you to schedule an appointment. You may also call 414-270-4653. Don't delay. Call us today. Again, that's 414-270-4653. Or visit us online at keepwarmmke.org. This is administered by the State of Wisconsin Home Energy Plus Program.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee. Something Real with your host, Michelle Bryant, on 860 WNOV.
All right, family, welcome back to the show. Michelle Bryant talking elections. I went to vote yesterday, got my I voted sticker, ran into some listeners to the station, and was taking selfies. I was like, we're going to get put out. Taking selfies at the polling location. So that part was pretty cool. Before I got off the air yesterday, a couple of people talked to me about the referendums that appear on the ballot. There are three, two statewide, in relationship to how we take outside money, if you will, from organizations seeking to influence voter turnout in the city, state, different municipalities. And the other referendum had to do with Milwaukee Public Schools. I think we did a fair enough job talking about the MPS referendum, although I'll mention it a couple of more times leading up to Election Day. That idea that they are seeking $252 million to be able to assist with a number of, you know, priorities at the district. We know that the district requested money about 3-4 years ago in a referendum. They are back again. The concern that has been raised is, will they be back again in another 3 years? Because we know that there are some huge deficits in terms of education funding that have created some problems. The one thing, though, that folks have said is, I want to understand how you've been fiscally responsible with the money that we provided. I think it was $84 million in that last referendum, what we're talking about now. So I tell people on the MPS referendum, you got to vote your conscience. You know, what do you want to do? And do you fully understand how all these dollars are being spent and allocated? Yes, sir.
And if you were paying attention to the MPS spot that just ran a promotion, two school board directors, Daryl Jackson and Aisha Carr, will be in this Friday, 7 a.m. to 9, to further discuss it from a school board standpoint. So, quite sure.
Well, let me just be clear, from their standpoint.
From their standpoint.
Yeah, because I don't know that all school board members were 100% on board, so we'll see. I know that a number of state legislators have come out in support. Local officials have come out in support, but there are some state legislators that are sitting on the fence as well. And so people are really trying to work through that whole piece. The other two referendums. So we have an amazing group of folks in Madison that, when you have certain things like, can you break this down for me? Can you help me better understand? They actually took on the two constitutional amendments that are on the ballot, because these would change our constitution if they were put into effect. Republicans would like to see laws that would prohibit a, you know, individual like a Mark Zuckerberg, who had come in with about, and Mark Zuckerberg is Facebook, had come in with about $350 million in grants, he and his wife, that they made available to municipalities all over the country to be able to take advantage of dollars. In Wisconsin, it was about $10 million. Municipalities from all over the state took advantage of it. And I think they said 38 of the 72 counties, they took advantage of those funds. This was coming off of COVID-19, trying to help people administer elections. And so what the funds were donated to do, this is what the money was intended for: poll worker recruitment, hazard pay, and training. Because again, remember, people were scared to work the polls during COVID. Polling place rental sites. Why we have changed from the Midtown location for Capitol voting versus now going over to the new Capitol Center, which is that bank across the street on 60th, is because what the rental costs were to rent the Midtown facility. Temporary staffing support, drive-through voting, equipment to process ballots and applications so that we can move this stuff through in a much more efficient and timely way. Personal protective equipment, so making sure that workers had masks and hand sanitizers during COVID. Nonpartisan voter education from cities and counties. The Republicans don't want anybody to be able to help the cities pay for that. That's what these referendums are about. Because the more people that show up to vote, particularly in the state of Wisconsin, the less likely it is that Republicans win. I'm just going to be, I mean, you know, y'all already know what I do. You know where I work. You know what my partisan affiliation is, but this has nothing to do with that. I outline for you what those dollars were used for. How are you against being able to say, we want to be able to help provide money for polling locations? We want to be able to make sure people have what they need to be safe to work in our polling locations. How are you against that? Because when you look at the amount of dark money that's in campaigns, which I talked about yesterday, we have multimillionaires, billionaires who are able to put unfettered dollars and amounts of money into campaigns on dark money. And, you know, the more the merrier. But if you want to do something to actually help people, help the elections, help things run efficiently, can't have that. So I am telling people, and you know, on some stuff I stay out of it, some stuff I'm very vocal and adamant about it. On those two referendums, my recommendation is that you vote no to both. And they read, in terms of the question, use of private funds in election administration, shall Section 7, one of Article 3 of the Constitution be created to provide that private donations and grants may not be applied for, accepted, expended, or used in connection with the conduct of any primary election or referendum. No, on both of those referendums. All right. I told you before I went to the break that we were going to be fortunate enough to have one of the candidates in studio that is running for Milwaukee Comptroller. Hello, Mr. Christensen. How you doing this morning?
Hi, Michelle. I am doing great. How about yourself?
Good. You're looking all shiny and spiffy, like I'm ready to get at it. So let me just ask this question, Bill. For folks that, and I know you've been in the studio, you've done a couple of other shows. Mm-hmm. For any of my listeners and folks that miss those opportunities that are not familiar with you, let's do the tedious part first, you know, but I think I like it the best. When people actually figure out who you are, not connected to county or city government and these roles that you're applying for, but like, I just want to know the man, you know, I just want to understand who this guy is, background a little bit. So are you from Wisconsin?
I'm from Milwaukee.
Are you really?
Yes. Okay. Lifelong Milwaukee resident.
Okay. Yep. Okay. Where'd you go to high school?
I went to Pius.
Really?
Yeah.
So there was some booze. I heard it in the background.
Oh, come on.
If Keith is in the studio, Dominican.
Yes.
You know, yeah. So I know that is in the background. Y'all stop hating. Be nice. So you went to Pice. When did you come out of high school?
2004.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Whoa. Man, I'm a lot older than you. Okay, just having
full
a
disclosure, I'm 38 years old.
Really? Okay, yeah. Okay. Look, I didn't want to do
just
the
get
math.
Get that out of the way.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. So, Milwaukee native, high school here. So, you go to school. What do you do after high school?
So, after high school, I went to college at UW.
Oh, wait. Let me stop.
Oh, sure.
Any sports in high school?
Yes.
What?
Okay. So I played football and I ran track.
All this height, no basketball?
No basketball.
How tall are you, Bill?
I'm 6'3".
Oh my
God. I know. It was very competitive at Pius.
Okay. So you ran track and played football.
And I played football.
What position?
A little bit of everything.
Really?
I played defensive end and tight end.
I was going to say at least tight end for sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I was a skinny guy. Yeah. And we played against some really, really powerhouse schools.
Okay.
And I got pushed around. I've still got a little ringing in my ears from taking hits from the Arrowhead offensive line.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I have done some work with Arrowhead High School. So, I mean, you know, it's funny because I tell people, I got the best of both worlds because I was raised partially in New York, partially in the South. And in the South, football is king. As you know, I'm sure just being around, you can tell football is king. So when my son went to, he played at Rufus King. And so when he went to go play college ball, my son up here was a big dude, you know, like in that, you know, elite in terms of physical specimens. He gets down South and he said they had this exercise, I think it was something like the bull ring or something. You stand in the center and cats try to knock you out of the center. My son called me. He was like, man, these the biggest men I have ever seen. He was like, mama get killed out here. You know? So he hung in there. He played. He did well. But yeah, when you talk about like taking some hits, it's amazing. So, okay. And then in track, what'd you do in track?
I was a distance runner.
Oh, okay.
My specialty was the 800.
Really?
Yeah. So
All right.
So half mile.
We did well.
We did okay. I wasn't a naturally gifted athlete. I worked hard, but I wasn't a naturally gifted athlete.
I like that too, y'all. For folks that watched on Facebook, you saw him clench them hands, but I worked hard, Michelle. I was doing it. So you graduated from high school, and so when you left high school, what was the big plan? What was the future? Like, I'm going to be
well. I didn't have a plan at that point. I will say this:
okay.
my mom and dad were both city workers. My dad was a firefighter, and my mom was an MPS teacher.
Okay.
So public service was in my blood.
All right.
And I always knew that that was an option, but it wasn't like I set out as an 18-year-old graduating from high school and says, I'm going to work for the city of Milwaukee, and that's where I'm going to spend my career. It was.
So what did you think you wanted to do? You still was trying to figure it out? Like, still, did you know, I'm going to college, I'm not going to college?
I knew I was going to college, okay. Yeah. My mom was insistent on that.
Okay, well, teacher, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And so where'd you go to college?
UW Oshkosh.
Okay, all right. And are there any party pictures? Will I find you?
They're out there. You know Oshkosh, right?
Yes, I do.
That's why I'm like,
is there anything incriminating? Any, surprises? We should be okay. You got through safe. What did you end up majoring in?
So I majored in history. Because I always knew I was going to go to grad school. Okay. I always knew that that was a part. So I majored in history. I minored in political science.
Mm.
And really, it taught me research, reading, preparing, doing my own analysis. I think the cool thing about history to me is there's always an interpretation. There's always like a new angle, a new light to shine on things. And to me, that's what led into the public policy side, because history, a lot of it is history of governments and nations, and that's what piqued my interest. And moving on to my next chapter at UW-Milwaukee, I got my master's of public administration. So I heard about the program while I was going to school at UW-Oshkosh, and I knew that that was something that I wanted to do. Once I heard what it was, I didn't even know that that was a program, and once like, I heard about it, I was hooked. Yeah.
So then first job is what?
First job was City of Milwaukee Budget Office.
Really?
So yes, I was an intern. There was a requirement as part of your master's program that you intern somewhere.
Okay.
And I had been working, just kind of like odd jobs, just, help pay the bills a little bit. And then I got an internship, and a lot of the students that were in my program, they were taking unpaid internships with other municipalities, smaller villages and towns. And I heard of an opportunity with the city of Milwaukee that was actually paying. So I thought, oh, well, I can't pass up on this.
This will work. And so what did you actually do in that role?
So I had kind of thought that this internship was going to be, they might feed me a few special projects, and, it was going to be very light, and I was going to be, not having a whole lot to do. But no, I was thrown right into the fire. They needed me in that moment. They needed somebody to fill essentially a full-time role. So I had assignments in the budget office. You're assigned a set of departments that you work with. And I was assigned to departments, and it was, okay, these are yours now. Start developing the budget. And so for me as a 24-year-old intern analyst, I'm sitting there telling some of these department heads that have been with the city for many years, so experienced, and people that I looked up to, and I'm saying, well, I know you want this, you need this, but here's what we can afford, so how are we going to make this work? So it was kind of a weird like power dynamic. Here I am.
I was going to say, so how well liked were you? Because it's awful when you got to be the one, and I tell people all the time, it's not what you say, it's how you say it.
Right.
But if I'm the one that has to bear, bring the bear of bad news, or we got to have different options, you got to think about this thing differently. Did you ever go in at that point, because thing we would always say, don't just give me the bad news, give me some suggestions. So is that any within the purview and the scope of what you were doing, or you just said, hey, these are the dollars, y'all need to figure it out?
Well, I think there was an evolution. I think any person that's gone through that office, the budget office is like a great place to launch your career. You learn a lot of things, you make a lot of connections. And the evolution that a lot of people go through is you start as kind of a gotcha analyst. You think your department is trying to trick you or hide something, or so you go in and you think, oh, I see what you did here, and I know what you're up to. But you learn that over time, and this takes years, that it's much better to advocate for them, to work with them as an ally and say, hey, look, here's what I'm facing.
Because understand, and that was the biggest thing when I pay attention to these particular roles. We're on the same team, man.
Correct.
Now, mind you, I'm trying to figure out a way to get every dollar I can from my department, my division, my people, my colleagues that work with me. But at the end of the day, we really are on the same team. So ultimately, you complete this internship. When do you actually start working for the city?
Or? So it was a year into my internship. So I was an intern for a year, and it started off as like 20 hours a week. And then they asked me if I could come in more. And eventually my boss, Mark Nicolini, the budget director, he asked me, he's like, well, can you just come in 40 hours a week and make it a normal job? I said, well,
so this is why you're still finishing grad school.
Yeah. Well, okay. I'm still finishing grad school.
Okay.
I know a lot of people do that, you know, school full time and work full time. But that was tough. Almost as tough as campaigning for comptroller.
Oh, my God. So, you know, let's do with it. So, OK, so you get this experience. You decide that this is the arena. This is the area. Like, yeah. OK, Michelle, I found my jam. You know, I like doing this. For folks that don't fully understand or appreciate the role of the comptroller, what would you say to lay people trying to understand what the responsibilities of this office are?
Sure. So the comptroller is the comptroller's office is like the central hub through which all financial transactions in the city are processed. So the comptroller is in charge of setting accounting policies, setting financial policies, in charge of audits. So auditing city finances and city operations. So making sure, looking for fraud, waste, and abuse, inefficiency, that type of thing. The comptroller is in charge of payroll. So making sure that the thousands of staff that are employed by the city are paid accurately and on time. The comptroller is in charge of managing the city's debt profile. So selling bonds and managing relationships with bond rating agencies and with investors. And our debt profile is over $1 billion. So, I mean, the stakes are incredibly high. The comptroller reviews tax increment financing proposals. So new tax increment districts and amendments to tax increment districts. We do reporting to the state. I mean, we're an office of 51 people, 7 divisions, covers a wide variety of different things, but I'd say our bread and butter is general accounting. So that's, you know, accounts payable, accounts receivable, financial reporting. We prepare the annual comprehensive financial report, and proud to say that we are the award-winning annual comprehensive financial report. We won in 2021 and 2022 an award for excellence in financial reporting from the Government Finance Officers Association. So I just want to give a little plug and a shout out to Aicha Sawa, current comptroller, for helping make that happen, and the whole team at the comptroller's office for making that happen.
So, you know, the thing that's interesting, outside of the one individual who's gotten into the race, who, you know, I'm just going to be honest, a lot of people are like, why? Just because of, you know, if I could, in this moment, age, length of time, out, you know, like, it's just, none of it fits. None of it makes any sense to a lot of people. But it doesn't seem like this is a job that a lot of people chomp at the bit to run for. I mean, you would think, given the reach and the scope of responsibilities, in some cases, quite frankly, the power that goes with a role like this, I wonder why we don't see that many people running for comptroller.
Well, I mean, what I can say from campaigning is, I mean, campaigning for office is a grind.
Yes, it is.
It's a ton of work. I did not realize what all went into this before. You know, I used to think,
particularly on a citywide race.
In a citywide race, yeah. And the hard part is, you know, if you're the mayor, people understand what the mayor does, right, what the mayor can do, whereas the comptroller, I mean, as much as I'd like to say, I'm going to lower your taxes and we're going to fix your potholes and I'm going to lower crime. I mean, that's not within the scope of what the comptroller does.
And some people would even say, in fact, you may prevent me from getting my potholes fixed because you're like, we don't have the money to do that. Or, you know, we got to tighten our budget over here. Or, you know, so it is one of those high profile, but rarely understood kind of roles. Not the sexiest in terms of, like you said, what I can campaign on,
right,
and help people appreciate about the job, but it's a critically important role.
It is.
I'm going to tell you, you know, my frustration, and this is just a sidebar, because we know that we've seen incidences where African-American, particularly African-American men, have run for comptroller positions. And, you know, I don't know if I mentioned this to you.
I think you did. Yeah.
When we talked at the King Day, King Fest celebration.
Yes.
You know, but, And watching what happened to these Black men who were running for these positions, and the attempt to, you know, try to call in the, you know, question ethics and this kind of thing. So it seems like when I've looked at it, I'm like, you appreciate how really truly important this role is, at least for me, because of what has been done to stop people from trying to run for it. So again, helping our community understand this is a position you really need to pay attention to. You really need to go into it as clear-eyed as possible, understanding what the responsibilities are and understanding who the candidates are that are seeking, you know, this role. Well, everything can be perfect. You know, I'm assuming you're running. I mean, and one, you could say, no, Michelle, I want to just keep it going. Want to make sure we continue to win those awards. The department thrives. Or, you know, are there things that you're saying, but if given the opportunity, day one, I'd like to, or there are things I think we could do better. Or does any of that come to mind for you in terms of leading the department?
No, it's a fair question. I think there's a few things that I'd like to make priorities if I'm elected comptroller. One is to take steps to improve the city's bond rating. So it's like the credit score for the city.
I was going to say, help people understand what the bond rating is.
Yeah, so it's consider it just like a credit score for the city.
And our credit score right now is?
So with there's three rating agencies. With Fitch, we are BBB+. And okay. With Moody's and S&P Global, we're at the low end of the A scale.
Okay.
So we've seen some downgrades in recent years, mainly due to kind of structural budget problems and our unfunded pension
liability. I was
going to
say, the pension has been one of the things that I've seen frequently that's kind of affected our bond rate.
Yes. And I think with the financial provisions of Act 12, we're going to see some relief there. And I think we've been taken off of negative outlook.
Just remind people what Act 12 is.
Oh, so Act 12 was legislation that was passed by the state of Wisconsin that did a number of things. The financial provisions included a 2% city-only sales tax, which has restrictions on its use. It's primarily used for paying for our unfunded pension liability, essentially pension bills that haven't been paid yet,
right.
And for enhancing or expanding public safety, so fire and police. It also increases shared revenue. This is essentially a transfer payment from the state that had been flat. And I mean, flat, not even in like inflation. I mean, flat in dollar terms for 20 years. So now we're seeing growth year over year in shared revenue. So I think that's a positive thing. And then it also soft closed the city's pension system. So what that means is somebody like me that started, you know, in 2010, I'm still going to be on the city's pension system, but new employees as of January 1st, they're 2024, they're going to be going on to the state's pension system.
That's the one that I'm under, WRS.
WRS, yeah.
And, you know, and one of the things that I guess as somebody who would be in this chair in terms of the comptroller's office, you know, when we looked at the restrictions that were put in place with Act 12, some of the questions that, you know, residents have said is, while that addresses this issue, you know, we had been hearing up until that point, the city, we're about to go off a financial cliff. And so does Act 12 position us to be any better financially to the point that we're no longer going off the cliff, or did it just buy us some time and we're still teetering, you know, on the edge financially?
It's a very good question. I think we certainly steered clear of the financial cliff. I mean, the scale of what we were facing, just to put it in context. So we were talking in 2024 without Act 12, a deficit of something like $150 to $180 million.
Right.
So to make that real to people, you could take every single department that's located in the building of City Hall. So that's the mayor's office, the common council, my office, the comptroller's office, the Department of Administration, all of these departments that are physically reside in City Hall, and eliminate them, which as impractical as that is, you obviously can't do that, right? If you eliminate them, that saves you about $60 million. So that's, you know, a third
of the
way there.
Well, that was quite the picture. So like literally, you still would even be halfway there, though, you know, to have dealt with that $150 million deficit.
Right.
Okay, so with Act 12 coming through, you know, what kind of time did we buy ourselves? As somebody who has, you know, some insight behind the scene in terms of these numbers, what does this look like for us in the future? What should voters understand?
Well, I think over the next few years, I think the 2024 budget, we were able to do a lot of things in the 2024 budget as a city that we took care of things that we had been wanting to do, but didn't have the financial capacity to do. We paid for some projects in cash that we normally would have borrowed for. So what that, I mean, that has the effect of essentially paying yourself in the future, because you would otherwise be borrowing for that. So I think that helped us.
Eliminating interest and all kinds of.
Exactly. But we're going to be facing some headwinds again. And I think that's going to, it's going to start in the 2025 budget. So the next budget cycle, we went from 2024 budget, we really didn't have to make any cuts to services. The 2025 budget, I think we're going to be back to, so, I mean, my whole career in the budget office, we were making incremental cuts. So you'd ask your department, okay, what can you do with a 2% cut, a 3% cut? And I have no idea what that number is actually going to be, because I'm not in the budget office anymore. I mean, they're the ones with the latest numbers. But I think we're not, it's not good times, and we're still going to be facing headwinds. And but I think it's nothing close to the scale of what we were facing with the fiscal cliff.
And I mean, you know, when you think about like the money that was used to prop up the budget, I mean, I say this all the time, COVID was a blessing and a curse, because dollars that came in, you know, by way of ARPA funds, you know, we were able to kind of avert some of that for a while. But that has been one of the concerns that I hear from callers to the show. When I'm out in the community, people are like, even with Act 12, you know, because of the restrictions on how those dollars could be used, are we positioned to go into 2025 and beyond and be okay? Or are we still, you know, hanging in the balance? Anything else, you know, that you think about, if I had the opportunity to revisit, to do differently, to add to the portfolio, what else would you be looking at?
Yeah, sorry, I totally forgot that original question.
Yeah, no, it's okay, it's okay.
So I want to build on some of the transparency initiatives that have been put in place. So one of the things that was done quite recently in the comptroller's office is we put something called Open Checkbook on the city's website. Mm-hmm. And what that is it's a searchable database that shows that you can go in and look at who the city pays, what we pay them for, and how much we pay them. And I mean, that throws the books wide open. I mean, this is information.
Wow. How long has that been in place?
We might be going on pretty close to a year now.
Really?
Yeah. And so that's something that's out there. It's been out there. And what I'd like to do, though, right now, you almost need to know what you're looking for. It's not very friendly for somebody that's, you know, oh, I just want to learn a little bit more generally about how the city spends its money. Yeah.
Okay. So
what I'd like to do is expand it and make it more accessible for somebody who, you know, they don't know exactly what they're looking for, but they want to know something like, well, hey, how much has the city collected in property taxes over the last 10 years? How much does the city spend on snow plowing? How much does the city spend on paving? You know,
so really, you know, to get a little bit more granular and in terms of what people can search for on the site, because that's one thing with us, you know, at the state level, the devil's in the details, because you'll see these line items and you'll, you know, but like you said, trying to figure out what is captured under each of those categories, or specifically like, look, I don't want to, you know, take the long way around. Can you just give me a straight line to getting that information,
right,
you know, on what we spend? I like that idea. I was not familiar that was a thing that was on the website.
Yeah.
So now I'm getting ready to go be nosy.
Oh, please do.
So, you know, we don't have a ton of time left.
Sure.
But for folks that, because like I said, you do have an opponent. I'm just going to be transparent. I just don't understand why, Mr. Gross got into the race. I just don't get it. But hang on, let me see. What is your guest stance on an audit of the Milwaukee Police Department? That was a question that just came through.
So our office conducts audits regularly. I mean, we do about 12 what they call performance audits in a given year. So we have audited certain aspects of the Milwaukee Police Department. We audited use of overtime in the Milwaukee Police Department. And all these reports are we're publishing them on our website, and they're also available on the city's website through Legistar. We regularly evaluate where risk is in the city.
Did you find any abuse of overtime?
Well,
because you know, I'm my Milwaukee Bucks moment. and the officer singing money, 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 money. It just comes to mind right away. So I guess I'm just kind of curious.
I think abuse might not be the word I would use, but I think there were some areas where there could be controls that were, could be put in place.
Okay.
So I think auditing different, what you don't do with audits is just like do kind of a fishing expedition. We're just going to audit the entire department. You kind of need to scope it out. So to audit an entire department for, it's like, well, what exactly would we be looking for? So I think we run that through our kind of risk matrix, where we look at, okay, where are the risks to the city financially? Where are the risks operationally, technologically? So if it's an IT risk. So we run all that through, and then we prioritize our audits based on that risk. So, I think doing Milwaukee Police Department audits, that's something that we have done and we likely will continue to do.
Okay. So I'm not going to go hard because we only got a couple of minutes and I got the county coming in. But I know that probably piqued a lot of interest from listeners because, like I said, we go back to, like, it was 11 police officers standing there for one guy. Yeah, it was amazing. But anyway, so for folks that are saying, I heard a lot. I think I like this guy. What final push would you just say for people that are either still sitting on the fence or, not sure yet who they want to cast their ballot for?
Sure. Well, I would say, I'm currently the deputy comptroller. I'm number two in the office. I can get the job done. 14-year public finance professional, all with the city of Milwaukee. I'm a certified public finance officer, lifelong city resident, and I'll be able to step in on day one and get the job done. And you can have confidence that city finances are being managed professionally.
Don't hold the pious thing against him. Well, Bill Christensen, thank you so much. And I will just say, too, for transparency, Bill, we had talked about, I got to get you on the show. But Bill did the follow-up. Bill made sure that the dots got connected. He wanted to come and speak to this listening audience. And he was like, hey, Michelle, over here. You see my text messages? Get back to me. So how much I appreciate that level of diligence in making sure that voters on my show had an opportunity to hear from you. Good luck to you, man.
Thank you so much, Michelle. Right. Appreciate the opportunity.
Election day, we roll people through just to, help spur voter turnout, remind people. So I'll reach back out to you, see if you want to come through on election day.
Please do.
Or again, before, and just talk to the folks one more time.
Sounds great.
All right. Thank you. All right, family. I got to take a quick break. Michelle Bryan, Say Something Real, talking politics for just a moment this morning. Mr. Bill Christensen running for Milwaukee City Comptroller. Because we got a county comptroller, so we got to make sure we understand the difference. All right, family, I'll be right back.
Do you love Jamaican food? Well, visit Fireside Jamaican Cuisine, new location at 7434 West Capitol Drive. Stop in for your Jamaican fix. Jerk chicken, oxtails, jerk egg rolls, and more. Daily specials will be available along with the original menu items from the previous Villa Avenue location. Business hours are Tuesday through Saturday, 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. and Sundays, 12 p.m. to 8. For more information, please call 414-509-5579. 414-509-5579.
The Center for Teaching Entrepreneurship presents its third annual Big Head Soiree Thursday, May 16th at the Marcus Performing Arts Center in the Bradley Pavilion. I'm Andrea Williams, and I'll be your host for this spectacular event. It's designed to salute the co-founder, Miss Radonna Rogers, as she loved to wear big hats, and this is one way we honor her. We will also celebrate and recognize the accomplishments of Milwaukee's leaders in entrepreneurial ventures.
TTE was founded with the mission in mind to help young people understand business, financial literacy, and themselves, and how they can find their way into the marketplace and be productive citizens. We have found a great way to educate, stimulate, and advance what we're doing within this community.
So, ladies, this is the time to wear your big hat, and guys, your stylish fedora. You will be treated to a delectable dinner and the sounds of Soul Sirius starting at 5:30. The program will begin at 7 with more entertainment and the awards program. Tickets are just $75.
tickets, go to Eventbrite using VHS24 or call 414-788-8104. That's 414-788-8104. This event will kick off the spring season, so don't miss it.
Increase in taxes while families are paying more for everything from gas to groceries is wrong. Milwaukee voters should oppose increase in property taxes by nearly 30% in order to provide increased funding yet again to Milwaukee Public Schools. They've already wasted nearly $1 billion in new taxpayer funding, and now they want more? They don't even have a plan on how they'll spend it. Enough is enough. Milwaukee voters should just say no.
Paid for by Enough is Enough. Vote no.
Black history is something to appreciate, celebrate, and participate. Play Ode is a mobile app that streams America's best Black-owned radio stations and podcasts from across the country. ODE stands for Our Digital Entertainment. Play Ode features music and entertainment for us and by us. Listen to WNOV The Voice Milwaukee on the Play Ode app. Elevate your radio listening and participate in supporting Black radio. Download PLAYODE or log on to odeaudio.com for info and insight.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Something Real with your host, Michelle Bryant, on WNOV.
All right, folks, welcome back to the show. Got a caller to hell through the break. Let me get her in before, and I'm just saying her because I can see the caller ID, before we go into our next segment. But I want to remind people, you can check us out on Facebook, 860 AM WNOV, or on YouTube. If you, you know, trying to see what folks look like in the studio, Kiana took his little hat off, so the lack of sexy, you know, is relevant right now. He was cute when he first started the show.
Your daddy.
Yes, my daddy is handsome. Yes, he is.
Like
he looks like Frederick Douglass, but my daddy is fine. I just want to be clear. Let me go to the phone line. Hey, caller, what's happening?
Good morning, Michelle. Excellent interview.
Thank you.
A bill at a number of stations. That's because he has a good campaign manager knowing where to hit the spot in a community where you see an abundance of African Americans there. Well spoken. But you know something that always puzzles me is where you know where the water cooler is, you know where the bathroom is, you know where everybody is and who to cut because you've been there 14 years. You've been brought up through the grave. So day one would not be a very complicated day for him because he knows what's going on. But at the same token, sometimes fresh eyes, and I hope anybody that's running for this position would know that it's critical that what are the key points that are holding us back? And when you do policy and procedure on things, some things are just cut and dry. And you can't go in there making your own rules. And for the bonds and everybody, every department should be on board. So all the pressure of the world is not on just the controller, but his eyes have to be on everything. So I'm saying we should always keep an open mind. And like I said, he's already been in the position for day one. Some things are going to be as usual, business as usual. And when someone new wants to come in, they make life difficult for them because you already dug in the trenches and you've got accustomed to things and you don't want to change. So we have to be mindful of everything, open-minded about everything. And hey, we got our work out for us. That's all I have to say. Great to see you.
All right. Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And, you know, and I appreciate because I made him uncomfortable and he handled it well the first time he met, because I'm not kidding. I've always been concerned that when we've seen African-Americans run for the comptroller position, whether it was Jason Fields, whether it was Johnny Thomas, and, you know, the things that were done that were divisive and, you know, in some problem in cases, you know, trying to figure out how to get rid of these people as candidates. And you ask the question like, well, why? What's going on in these departments that you don't want different eyes, you know, in the room? And so I wasn't playing when I asked that question, because I will never get over what, you know, happened with Johnny Thomas. I thought that was the most unfair, ridiculous thing I had ever seen. The question beckons, why? Why are those things being done? So I appreciated his candor and his answers and his responses. And I was teasing him when I met him. I loved, he wears this really, nice overcoat. And it's a really odd color, you know, like this, almost like this, just a little bit off the beaten path of a purple kind of coat. And I'm like, oh my God, y'all know how I pay attention to clothes. I'm like, that's a bad coat. And he turned around, his wife was standing there. He was like, yeah, you can thank her, you know? And so he had on something similar today. I was like, tell the wife, I said, good job. He started laughing, you know, so somebody willing to listen. you got to appreciate that. All right, so let me take a minute and turn the conversation. As folks know, we are fortunate every single month to have folks in from Milwaukee County Office of Equity, and they bring in different department leadership throughout the county to talk to us about, you know, an array of services, resources, just make us conscientious of the work that's being done in the county to help the community, to help us function, to help us, you know, just to help us. I'll just leave it there. And so this month, and let me just say, first of all, good morning to my Sara, Miss Jacqueline Zeladon. What's up, Sara? grab a mic. Oh, I love it. She's in the kiosk, y'all. We got a new producer in the studio. So I want to say good morning to her. This is to make sure that we have what we need to do these interviews and pulls all the people together. So always a big shout out to her. And we, you know, had a moment where we were letting our guests know that we live stream in the studio. And I was like, did you get your makeup? You good? You ready? He's so handsome. Like, I'm good, Michelle. Let's roll.
Oh, I don't know about that.
How you doing this morning,
I'm
James?
I'm doing great, Michelle. How are you?
I'm good. So that voice is Mr. James Matthew. James, tell people what the department is.
Yeah, so I am the administrator of housing services, and that's under the Department of Health and Human Services at Milwaukee County.
Your hands are full right now.
we're a little busy. We're a little busy, but I hope that's a good thing. So really, our focus is looking at housing under the social determinants of health. Mm. So we say all the time that housing is health. Housing is healthcare. That's why it's a really good fit for us to be in the Department of Health and Human Services. We're the only housing division with our service type in the country that's under a Department of Health and Human Services, which is really unique and was done very intentional by the county years ago.
So before we do that, because I always, you know, with the benefit of streaming, people have an opportunity to see you, but I like people to understand who the folks are behind the scenes that are running these departments. People get antsy, you know, like, do these folks really appreciate the community, you know, that they serve? Do they understand who we are as residents and you know, the challenges sometimes that we face? So just for a little bit of background, backstory, are you from Wisconsin?
I'm born and raised Wisconsin. I grew up in La Crosse, Wisconsin.
Okay.
Moved to Milwaukee when I went to Marquette University. Fell in love with everything about Milwaukee and kind of stayed in the area ever since.
Well, you know, first of all, just that whole fell in love. I was waiting for you to say with some woman. met my wife and couldn't leave, you know, but that too?
Well, no, actually, fell in love with a job that kind of changed my career trajectory in college, actually, which kind of
got me. What was the job?
So I tell the story a lot. My staff knows the staff. So I came to Marquette thinking I was going to be an accounting major and go into business and all that jazz.
Okay.
Wasn't a very good fit for me. I was walking to class one day and saw a job posting for a second shift admissions worker at the guest house homeless shelter. And it just caught my eye. I applied, started that job, and within a month or two, I was kind of hooked. Changed my major, changed everything.
That's a major departure from
it was,
you know, white shoe firm, accounting, big bucks.
Yeah, it was. Because
you
know,
you understand the sacrifice. People, we try to help people appreciate that. I used to do that a lot. So I am Senator Taylor's. Well, I'm chief of staff in the office. When she was there, you know, we talk about that sacrifice from public sector to private sector, and that when you see a lot of these people working in public sector jobs, I mean, on public sector jobs, that these folks have usually walked away from positions that could have paid significantly more. That's the first bell for me that starts ringing about who these people are.
Yeah,
because you know, you. In some cases, sacrifice your own financial comfort to be able to serve a demographic, a community, to do a job. So, you know, hat off, because an accountant, yeah.
It was not fun. It was not fun. It's been a blessing, though. It's just been a blessing.
And so how do you ultimately end up navigating your way through so that you end up in the role you're in now?
So from there, I went to work at Wisconsin Community Services. Just as a case manager, kind of boots on the ground case manager for individuals with serious and persistent mental illness. Ended up running one of their outpatient mental health programs, and learned very quickly that none of the people I served had adequate housing.
So James, I gotta stop you for a sec.
Yeah.
What did your parents do?
So my dad is retired. Worked at Matthew Construction, Road Construction Company in La Crosse. So definitely different path than I chose, but like to think I have a little bit of business acumen from how I grew up.
I mean, you know, because it just like when I was just talking to Bill Christensen, he talked about his dad being a firefighter, mom being a teacher. Mm-hmm. And so that public service is kind of, you know, there, whether you appreciate it or not. Because I guess I'm still stuck, you know, when you talk about, hey, it came down from La Crosse, went to Marquette, going to do this. And then I see something and it moves me in a different way. I usually go back to, like, you know, the family, you know, what people have seen, work ethic, the things that people value and care about. And so now you brought this to Milwaukee County. So how long have you been with the county in total?
I've been with the county 19 years now. I started, so I moved from Wisconsin Community Services into the county as one of their first housing employees.
Okay.
So 19 years ago, the housing division, it's now known as Housing Services, but back then there was no housing division. So there was a series of newspaper articles about the housing conditions for people with mental illness that were receiving services through the behavioral health division. And it was a series of articles, article after article, about where's the housing for this population? What is the county doing about it? And that's what actually led to the creation of the housing division, to put a lot of things in place to laser focus on that community. And we took that over the years, and then address homelessness and those types of things with all of these services centralized in one area.
But I guess for folks that are kind of sitting back and listening to this whole thing, and they're trying to draw that line from individuals in the community with mental health challenges and, you know, home insecurity or homelessness, how does that become a county responsibility? You know, and like, did people really believe that the county should make sure that individuals had housing who found themselves in these situations? Help people, because there will be people that I know are like, I don't understand the correlation here.
It's a good question. I don't think going back 20 years ago, there wasn't enough of a conversation about housing and its relation to health. Nobody was talking about social determinants of health. Nobody even knew what that was 20 years ago.
Right.
So I think we were a little fortunate back then that the stars aligned, that all these services got put in one area. But I don't think anybody exactly knew what it would lead to today. But it was certainly the case that individuals we served, whether it's mental health or, as your audience would know, anybody that's low income, without the foundation of housing, you can't expect anybody's mental health to improve. You can't expect educational opportunities to improve unless you have that foundation of housing. It wasn't talked about that much then. But it was real from my experience, even as a case manager with folks struggling with mental health issues. Every one of them had housing challenges. You're living on a low fixed income. and nobody helping you find housing. It wasn't thought about as much back then.
But when we start to talk about the numbers, you know, when you think about when folks say, okay, we're going to tackle this housing crisis, you know, for a number of reasons, you know, mental health is just one of them, but we're going to tackle this housing crisis. What kind of numbers are we talking about? I mean, number one, are there enough resources to help all the people that need help? And I remember there was a push at one time under Abley's administration in which he talked about being able to deal with chronic homelessness.
Yeah.
You know, so whether I think at that time, I forgot how many people that, and there was a definition for chronic. You had to, you know, have appeared so many times within the chain of resources for assistance, and certain things had to be in place. But then there was a moment when, you know, the administration announced we've dealt with chronic homelessness. Mm-hmm. So is that still the case? And now what are we talking about by way of homelessness now? Is it two different things at this point? What are we doing now?
It's a great question. Thank you for bringing that up. So yeah, we worked to bring the concept of housing first to Milwaukee under the Abley administration late 2014. So the idea was to start with chronic homelessness. So for your audience, those that are homeless the longest, that have the most challenges, we start housing those individuals first and then kind of go with the severity of needs after that.
Okay.
So, you know, what the housing first philosophy is going to say is everybody deserves the dignity of housing, and we're focused on permanent housing, not just shelter, not transitional housing, taking individuals off the street and putting them into housing with no conditions.
How do you pay for this? I mean, because if you got people that have employment challenges, mental health challenges, you know, like, so is this housing that people are just given? How do people pay for this?
Sure. Great
question. How do we pay for it?
Yeah. So it's a mix of, I think some communities make the mistake of, you know, a city gets a certain amount of money from HUD and that's their homelessness response. That's never enough. It has to be a mix of federal resources from HUD, but also local government funds. And we've been blessed. Milwaukee County has invested a lot of county dollars into homelessness, and it's just made a huge difference. So it's everything from short-term rent assistance, but really our bread and butter is long-term rent assistance with federal funds, but also county funds for services. So when I say housing first, this isn't housing only. You don't get a rent assistance voucher and you're on your own after you're in housing. It's housing with voluntary support services on your own terms. We don't define what those terms are. The people we serve have self-determination about what they think their plan should be.
Connected, and I said this to Bill Christensen when he was in, COVID was a mixed thing,
yes.
Mixed bag. I almost said
absolutely.
Blessing. But it was because even given all of the health challenges, the loss of life in far too many cases, you know, I remember the very first person we lost in the county to COVID. It also provided an opportunity financially for communities, municipalities that were struggling as they received dollars from the federal government, some by way of ARPA funding.
Mm-hmm.
And so people were either able to prop up budgets, backfill budgets, get some of the wish lists, you know, projects taken care of. And how was Milwaukee County impacted by either ARPA dollars or the COVID crisis? Did funding come in? Well, I shouldn't say did, because I know it did. But just take a second and kind of help us understand that piece of it.
Yeah. So two different things I would say. During COVID, with the funds that came in, we were for the first time able to do programs that we really only dreamt about. So certainly COVID response on the street. One of the things that folks don't know is county government, we do our own homeless street outreach ourselves.
And that's done through the actual, I thought that was like a contracted agency.
No, we do it ourselves. It's their county branded vans. Hopefully some of your listeners see us out there. We're out first and second shift, Monday through Friday, homeless encampments, doing full service on the street directly into housing with our own outreach team.
So like full service, just quickly, what would people, you know, expect by way of saying full service? What are you guys out there doing?
It could be anything. So we're, you know, the idea is we don't want to have to wait for somebody to find us. We want to find people before they even know how to find us.
Okay.
So we're going out to, you know, under bridges, homeless encampments, making sure people are safe, but instantly start the discussion about housing. Are you interested in housing? The answer is always yes. Are you interested in shelter? The answer most of the time might be no. But if you're interested in housing, and you're willing to work with us through the process, that's what it's about. And sometimes it might take three times or five times or seven times to build the trust that we're serious. We actually have housing. Yes, we're a government agency, and you might not have had good experiences with governments in the past. So there's some of that trust building.
Right.
But after that, it's kind of A to Z working for to get people into housing. We have our own landlord engagement coordinator that works with landlords, has apartments ready. We do the subsidies. We do the services.
And just so you know, somebody just hit me. She's a regular listener and a huge community supporter. And she said, Michelle, I need to get his direct number so I can connect with them. She has a 4-unit apartment building, and she's been trying to figure out a use for it and what to do. And she is somebody that anytime somebody's called our station and they have a housing crisis, she has called and said, you know, let me figure out how I can help.
Well, hey, I'll take that public service announcement right now for any of your listeners.
Okay.
We're in a desperate hunt for 1-bedroom apartments.
Okay.
If any of your listeners kind of want to join us, we're looking for responsible landlords, particularly of 1-bedroom units. You know, one of the other challenges in housing in general in Milwaukee that a lot of folks wouldn't realize, we have the second most competitive real estate market in the nation right now for vacancy rates.
So what do you mean by that? Help listeners understand, what does that mean?
So basically, I think it's right around 3.6-3.7% is our vacancy rate in Milwaukee, which means 96% of our units are full.
So housing is scarce for people that's looking.
It is incredibly scarce. And imagine if you don't have a rental history,
right,
or you might have had, you know, issues happen with your credit, and now you're coming to work with us. We're fighting for these units just like everybody else is. We're in desperate need of new housing right now.
All right. So do I need to take a commercial? Okay, I need to take a commercial break, but I got a couple of questions. So I saw the announcement when the county exec talked about $18 million, mm-hmm. I think it was going into suburban communities to help with, low-income housing, I think kind of diversifying some of these communities and areas. I raised questions and concerns with him about, hey, just because, you know, this kind of money goes into a neighborhood, do we really get to see opportunities for particularly communities of color, for people of color moving into those communities? Are there checks and balances on what any of that looks like? So if I could, I'll just broach that topic when we come back from break.
Great.
All right. Michelle Bryant, WNOV. Now, do you go by Jim or James? Which one?
Whichever one you want.
I want to make sure, because, you know, I don't know how many guys I meet and their name is James. Like, just call me Jim, Michelle. I'm like,
don't call me whatever you want.
Well, either way, Mr. Matthew is in the building. We will be right back. He is the housing administrator for the Milwaukee County Department of Health and Human Services Housing Division. Got a lot of good questions coming through via text. We'll get to as much as we can, but let me take a break first.
School Board Director Daryl Jackson, who represent District 3 for MPS.
MPS School Board Director Aisha Carr representing District 4.
Tune in this Friday from 7 to 9 a.m. as we discuss
all things MPS referendum and as we talk about the state of emergency in education in the city of Milwaukee.
Easter and prom is here, and graduation is near. Stop by Nicovani's, where they have a large variety of suits, blazers, and shoes to get you right for that special day. You already know Nicovani has the $100 hookup. You can get a suit, shirt, tie, and shoes, all for just $100. They're open 7 days a week with an on-site tailor. Nicovani's on the second floor of the Mayfair Mall across from the movie theater. It's the place to shop for men.
Hi there, I'm Deslyn Smith, the Executive Director of United Garner Homes Incorporated, the proud sponsor of the Nyumbu Opendo Show, broadcasting on WNOV on Wednesdays at 11 a.m. poverty, illicit behaviors, drug abuse, and addiction have been affecting the quality of life for decades, not only in the Garden Homes neighborhood, but within disenfranchised communities throughout our country. United Garden Homes Incorporated is a neighborhood association-based nonprofit organization committed to supporting individuals and families to see beyond their current situation by way of education and mental health, substance misuse, and violence prevention, as well as with the utilization of resource advocacy to empower and promote healing in our community. For more information, contact United Garden Homes Incorporated at 414-554-5538 or via email at info@ughinc.org.
Impressions will exceed your expectations. Great impressions, perceptions, everything.
Are you ready to make a lasting impression? Look no further than Great Impressions Graphics and Printing. With over 25 years of excellence in the industry, we specialize in delivering top-notch printing solutions tailored to your corporate needs. Business cards, brochures, banners, annual reports, apparel, and promotional items. Our state-of-the-art technology ensures unmatched quality and precision. Call 414-536-7646 or visit greatimpress.com today to learn more. Trust Great Impressions to exceed your expectations and elevate your brand to new heights.
Impressions, perceptions, everything.
Hey, WNOV family, this is Will Martin, and I'm inviting you to join me for my new show, The Difference, every Monday from 3 to 4. Listen on your radio or stream us live on Facebook or YouTube.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Get up, let's get down. Roll with the hardcore funk, the hardcore sound. Let's get with this Macadocious funk material. So simple. When I rock with the instrumental, who am I?
Indeed, the Green Eyed Bandit.
Control my career so I can never get stranded. But the rest are getting brand new, being changed up their style. From jeans to suits and thinking about a pop record. Something made for the station. For a whole new relationship of a new type of scene. To go platinum and clock mad green. AKA a sellout, the rap death. Definition. Get off that boy, change your mission. Come back around the block. Pump color me bad to the TikTok. Let them know your logo. Not a black thing. My background sing for the crossover. Crossover. Era's out of control, brother selling his soul. Will go gold, going, going, gone. Another rapper sold to pop and R&B, not the MD. I'm strictly hip hop. I stick to kick a free funk mode. Yeah, kid, that's how the squad rolls. I know your head is bobbing, cause the neck knows.
Like other rappers,
putting on their fans, they ill trying to chill. Saying damn, it'll be great to sell a mill. That's when the mind switch to the pop tip.
Kid, you gonna be large.
Yeah, right, that's what the company kicks. Forget the black crowd, you're whack now. In a zoot suit, front and black, looking mad foul. I speak for the hardcore.
Rough, rugged, and raw.
I'm out of here, catch me chilling on my next tour. From the U.S. to the White Cliffs of Dover. Strictly underground funk, keep the crossover. Crossover. You wanna go pop, goes the weasel. You know you should be rocking the fans with something diesel. But you insist to piss me off black, so I flex the biceps so I can push them back. So real hardcore hip hop, continue records. And all sucker MCs duck down and get the message. So brand a crossover, yo, who's with me?
His squad,
yeah, hit another mega blast. Funky dope style from Cross Yonder.
So help me wander, help me wander.
From what? The crossover, yeah, crossing you over. Out of here, go on, peace,
see
nice,
ya.
What a way to go out, no clouds, what the fans. Shout
cause she got gas. Then took the wrong route, came on the scene, chillin', freaking a funky dope line. But when they finish with you, flatline. Some say there's no business like show business, but if this the truth, please explain why is this? Rappers been around long, making mad noise, you see. Still I haven't seen one rapper living comfortably. No time to pick and wish on the four-leaf clover. I stick to underground, keep the crossover.
WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee. Now back to Say Something Real with your host Michelle Bryant on 860 WNOV.
First lesson your parents teach you: don't judge a book by its cover.
Hey, hey.
We got somebody jamming in the studio. I'm like, hands nodding, like, wait, why are we playing EPMD? And Kia's like, I got a text. Somebody sent a message. This is James Matthews Jam. This is people.
I appreciate that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. He sure went to rock. Coming out. I was looking at him.
I'm like, what's happening here? Oh, my God. Oh, okay. Look, thank you for that tip. For the family that checked in, see somebody out here know you, James. All right, folks. So we are so fortunate. The Office of Equity with Milwaukee County does a great job of making sure we get connected to department heads, agency liaisons, bringing us critical information. There has been a commitment made to address and deal with the social determinants of health, understanding that all of these things combine to either create successful communities that thrive. You know, people are able to advance, take care of themselves. If they go unaddressed, then we understand the implications of how it can just derail a whole family. You know, take you, you know, like my son always says, knock you right off your square. And, you know, you need some additional help and resources. So right now, this conversation is wrapped up into the concept of housing and the way that is a determinant. You know, so two things. So I had an occasion. I went to go visit Andre Lee Ellis one day at his home when he was living over near 9th and Ring. And he and I were meeting on something else. And he had an upstairs kind of loft area in the home, just beautifully done, like a man cave. It was great. We were meeting up there. And then as we were talking, he said, I want to show you something. And so we looked out this back window. And there was a van that was pulling in. And he said, this is about the time that this family pulls in, that they clearly are homeless. And this is evidently what they feel like, a safe space to park. And so it looks like literally after these folks go to work, they get the kids from school, as a family unit, they're parking that van and they're sleeping in that van overnight. And then And I'm just sitting here looking at him like, what? And he was like, yeah, it's right here in our backyard. You know, it was in the alley right behind the house. I then have had an opportunity where I was downtown one day. I talk often about there are things that I think are mine. And I realize that God had a different idea. Like, I was the pass through, that those things were never really for me. And this is so simple, I was like, I'm really hungry and I haven't had brick pizza in a long time. So I live on the Northwest side. I drove downtown to Brick Pizza and this is just going in and get a couple slices, but I just love, cause it reminds me of New York. So I wanted some brick pizza. As I'm getting ready to go in, this young brother sees me and he says, excuse me, miss. Looks real disheveled. You can tell something's going on. He says, excuse me, miss. I said, hey, what's up? He said, would you mind, getting me a slice of pizza when you get yours, if that's, you know, if you can, if that's okay. I said, yeah. I said, well, what kind do you want? He said, whatever you buy. I said, no. I said, because I don't eat anchovies. I don't like this. I don't like that. And I said, so tell me what you want. And he was a young guy. He couldn't have been much more than like 20. And so he said, pepperoni would be fine. And I said, okay. I said, you want something to drink? You know, so we're going through the whole thing. And he said, can I ask you another question? And I said, yeah. He said, would you mind buying two slices? And I said, yeah, you want two? He said, no, it's not for me. He said, since I've been out here in the streets, there's been a woman that's kind of been looking out for me. And she's right here. And, you know, he said, you know, if you're not scared, I said, I'm not scared. We walked around on the side and there was this older white woman sitting there. He was a young African-American male. He said, she's just kind of been showing me the ropes about being out here in the streets. And neither one of us have eaten today. And so he said, if you don't mind. And, you know, so I got two slices for both of them. I would have just bought the whole box, but, you know, storage wise, I didn't know what that was like. And, but, so that just stayed with me.
Sure.
You don't get to shake it. I've been in the neighborhood laundromat when people have come in to wash up in the bathroom. I worked on a political campaign, and I didn't realize this. There were a number of people that would volunteer in the campaign, and finally somebody pulled my coattail. They was like, you know, most of these people are homeless, Michelle. I was like, what are you talking about? It's like, because political campaigns, the campaign offices, they have food and coffee, you know, and people are volunteering. They can come in, they can get out of the elements, they get coffee, they eat snacks while they're there. And it never dawned on me until one night, it was freezing cold. I was working on Mary Burke's campaign for governor, freezing cold. And one of the guys, I said, let me take you home, you know, because I knew he caught the bus every day. I said, it's too cold for that. And I don't know what time the bus is coming. We had worked really late. And he kept saying, no, Michelle. Somebody said my voice was lowering again, maybe because I moved away from the mic. I'm sorry. But he said, no, Michelle, I'm good. I said, it is too cold. I will take you home. So I took him home, and I won't say where. But when we got there, I said, well, where's the house? I mean, where are you going? And so he finally said, Michelle, my son and I are homeless. He said, you see that big tree right there? And I was like, yeah. He said, we sleep under that tree. And the tree had low hanging branches, so you couldn't see the ground. And I said, what? He said, yeah. He said, we've probably been out here about 5 months, but he lost his place. I had lost mine first. He said, and so we got sleeping bags and stuff on there. I was like, it's freezing out here. He said, we'll be fine. We do it all the time. You don't shake those things.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm watching him come in our office every day. Great attitude. How can I help? You know, because it's not the image of what you think when you think about somebody that has homelessness issues. How, and I think that's why we saw that transition of the usage of the word. And I can't remember correctly right now, but like house, what is it? It's another word, that housing insecurity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they don't say homeless quite anymore. The work that's been done around this issue, can you speak a little bit to, number one, the housing efforts with the ARPA money that came in that went in the suburban communities? But anything you want to say about that homelessness piece too?
Yeah. So what I would say about that, Michelle, you mentioned before when we started under Chris Abley with Housing First, focused on chronic homelessness. You know, this is all good news and bad news. The good news is we've been more successful as a community than anybody else in the country eliminating chronic homelessness. We had the lowest unsheltered count in the nation 2 years in a row.
Unsheltered. That's what I was.
So that's phenomenal, right? Okay. That's great. That's the good news. The bad news is though what we're seeing now on the streets. We're not seeing any more chronically homeless folks, but a ton of people we've never seen before. People that have only been homeless for a month or two that are now entering the system in larger numbers than we would have ever seen before. So you brought up housing insecure.
Right.
These are those folks, and it's a misperception of homelessness. There's people that are working.
Yeah.
It's a different perception of what people think. So we've done a good job housing everybody who was long-term homeless. But there's a lot of new people entering our system that we typically wouldn't see. And those are individuals that may be working, may just have some short-term needs, but the numbers are growing with housing insecurity, no question.
So the money that came in, and I'm assuming this was via ARPA, this $18 million, county exec is out in suburban communities. I remember his phrase, we're here to share the love. And I was like, yeah, I don't know about that. talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, thank you for that. So yeah, incredibly blessed to have David Crowley as our county executive. So the amount of ARPA funds that the county has put into housing were really a game changer for us. So when we're focusing on suburban communities, there's a couple different reasons for that. The biggest one from a mission-based perspective is the issue of racial equity and the issue of mass segregation in Milwaukee County.
Right.
So that was one of the first things that we were going to be looking at. dire lack of affordable housing and certainly diversity in our suburban communities. So that was kind of the big overarching mission goal that the county had. The other thing is, you know, the city of Milwaukee has their own ARPA funds, their own housing authority, their own CDBG funds that can only be used in the city.
Right.
And that's a majority of the housing money in our community is city-based and not county-based.
Okay.
So our thought was, you know, let's work in communities that don't have access to the city's funds. So that's what we did. So we were looking at doing affordable housing, multi-unit in as many different suburbs dispersed geographically as possible.
But how do you get to that point? Because this was what I pushed the county exec on. How do you get to the point where you see what it is you were hoping to by way of mission, which is diversifying some of these communities, giving people from different racial backgrounds, ethnicities, even if you will, an opportunity to move into suburban communities? I mean, because, you know, we don't have the policing in place to be able to say who gets in, who's being denied. So what kind of checks and balances, if any, are on those dollars going in to advance that goal?
Yeah, appreciate that. So everything that we're doing, two different things. We're using development agreements that spell out affordability periods,
okay,
and what this has to go and what the inspections look like. So we're not just handing out a check to developers. We will be involved as housing services throughout the life of that building for 20 years.
Whoa, okay.
So this isn't just cutting a check and building a building. We're going to be involved making sure that we're still serving low income people.
See, this is why you talk to the people.
Yeah.
DC, this is a very thorough answer because it makes you nervous. Like I said, like you know, you're giving my hand people this kind of bread and you are going to make sure we do the right thing.
Oh yeah. No, yeah.
I just was a little iffy.
Yeah, that's a good point. No, we'll be on it for sure. The other thing that we're coupling with that, we want a competitive HUD grant for housing mobility.
Okay.
So it's about $1.8 million and it is to work with individuals who are in lower income neighborhoods to move to different areas of what HUD would call high opportunity, different school districts, wherever they want to be that they're normally priced out of.
Right.
So this grant will go hand in hand. We have financial services, employment services, housing search services that are for city residents that maybe want to move into these other communities and into the housing that we're building. So it all kind of weaves together.
I guess just one other quick question on that, because I want to work in the new services, senior services piece that we were talking about during our break. But, you know, so timeline, when do we start to see like some of these projects materialize? Do we know? Because there are people like, I would like to do that. I'd be interested in that. Do we have a timeline?
Yeah. So the timelines vary. We'll have construction starting on a few of them momentarily.
Okay.
Next year, we'll have two of them probably done this year and all seven of them done probably in the next 18 months.
So it's a seven complex or yeah, we've got total.
We've got buildings going up in Whitefish Bay, Brown Deer, South Milwaukee, Wauwatosa, Greenfield, Whitefish Bay.
The thing is like Brown Deer, I step one toe in, you know what I mean? It's not that far outside of what people are thinking, like, you know, how far out am I being asked to go to follow this housing to try to get these opportunities? But it's really fairly adjacent.
It is to
the city.
And a lot of it too for our mission is fair housing. And okay. It's really, I remember going into some of these suburban communities 5 years ago and it really wasn't a pleasant experience trying to talk about affordable housing.
And that's what I was going to say, receptiveness. But
it was tough. But I have to give all these municipalities credit. The conversation is dramatically different. And I think it goes to citizens of all these different suburbs are having their own affordability issues that they might not have had 5 years ago. So it's the reception's at least changed and the perception of what affordable housing is and isn't. It took us several years to get there, but I think we're finally making progress.
So someone who knows you and they call you Jim.
Uh-oh.
He said, Jim is the business and he really gets the mission. It comes through. It comes
through. Oh, I appreciate
the
that.
Genuineness, the concern and the care. So yes, I concur, Jeff.
appreciate
he
that.
Said Jim is the business. So take a second. New senior services. What's that about?
Yeah, so we've been talking about, you know, suburban affordable housing development, but really our bread and butter is typically City of Milwaukee residents. So two big initiatives, and this one we're really proud of. So a lot of your listeners know we're building a new health and human services facility, the COGS building on 12th and Belit.
Right.
The county didn't want it to be just a building and an anchor tenant. It was really about community revitalization and investment in that area.
Okay.
So new building is great. Services there are great. But what about the surrounding community? So we got a competitive grant from the state for $6 million in ARPA funds and are building 120 brand new single family homes in the King Park neighborhood for first time home buyers.
Single family homes.
Yep, it's happening right now. You'll see them going out. If you anybody going what? To the Cox building.
What, so for people that are like, I'm not really sure. What's the King Park area? Where are we talking?
Yeah, location? So where the MLK Center is, right on Belit, 12th and Belit, and kind of that King Park area. It's probably, you know, 10 square blocks or so.
Okay.
Virtually any vacant city lot you see there now will have a brand new single family house on it from the MM Group and Habitat for Humanity probably in the next 18, 24 months.
Oh my God, that's a game changer.
We think so. So it was a strategic investment. Again, it's not just, you know, health and human services, you know, about a building. It's really about, you know, trying to change a whole entire neighborhood at the same time.
There are folks that are familiar with the project and they're saying that they are super excited to live in the area.
We are too. And these will be, so construction costs are through the roof, but what that competitive grant did for us is we'll be able to, through Habitat for Humanity example, sell them at a very affordable price. We might've paid a lot more to build them, but families can't afford that nowadays.
Right.
So it'll be sold at a very affordable rate, through Habitat.
Okay, so my phone is ringing off. My text message is I'm getting pinged all over the place. So folks are asking if you wouldn't mind providing contact information. So whatever that would be, email address, phone number, whatever works for you. So I want to make sure I get that in.
Yep.
So think about that before we come back. I got to go take a quick break.
Yep.
And then final, you know, if there's anything we left out or things you know we need to understand and how people can either reach out for services, or to the people that called about having the rental units available. Okay. All right. Let me take my final break. Michelle Bryant, WNOV, 860 AM, 106.5 FM. I don't know if we're going to do EPMD in the break, but we'll be back.
There you have it.
There it is.
Hello, Milwaukee. I'm Mr. Debo, the program director here at the all-new 860 WNOV. On January 8th of this year, WNOV underwent a relaunch, complete with a fresh logo, branding, format, and new shows. Now you can even stream our talk shows on YouTube and Facebook. We're always striving to enhance your listening experience, and now your watching experience too. As we continue to work on improving, there may be more changes in our lineup. Here's a few of the changes we've made. We've added Sandra Silk and All That Jazz on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Chris Heavy Levy on Saturdays with Saturday Backtracks and more. Flavor Fix with foodie Samantha Starr. How about Pillow Talk with me, Mr. Debo? On the Porch with Kwai, with Kwabenon Anton Nixon. The Difference with Will Martin. Be a Voice with Wisconsin Voices, Dr. Kwaku and Nyumbo Mbindo. Money Talks with attorney Carl Plez. Brought to you by Columbia Savings and Loan. The Friday Night Jukebox Party with DJ Kevin Buchanan. St. Mark's Lutheran Church with Pastor Marty from 9 a.m. until 9:30 a.m. Community Outreach Clinics, Community Heartbeat, with more to come. But rest assured, of course, we have our staple shows that have not changed and will not change. Say Something Real with Michelle Bryant. Community Voice with Keith Paris. International Roots Rock Reggae Meltdown with Ross Joel. The Blues Cafe with me, Mr. Debo. Reverend Al Sharpton from 12 until 3. We're listening to you and we'll get it right together. And thank you for listening to the all-new 860 WNOV and 106.5 FM, The Voice.
If you're looking for mouth-watering eats and delectable treats, look no further. Eat local and visit the Sherman Phoenix today, where you can find everything from delicious organic wings and smoked barbecue to satisfyingly seasoned vegan food to sweet, buttery, made-to-order desserts. The Sherman Phoenix is also home to a day bar serving mixed, frozen, and tropical drinks. Experience the Sherman Phoenix effect at 3536 West Fond du Lac Avenue, open Tuesday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 7 p.m., and Saturday, 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. Visit theshermanphoenix.com to learn more.
Habari Ghani, this is the voice of the community found on WNOV 860 a.m., W293CX 106.5 FM. I'm Kwaku Amoasi, better known as the Blacksmith, Milwaukee's favorite psychologist, host of Nyumbu Upendo. This show will air every Wednesday from 11 to 12, where we will talk on all things mental health. When you need a healing for your mind, body, and soul, come to Nyumbu Upendo.
Hi, this is Keith Paris, the host of Community Voice, asking you to join us Mondays through Fridays from 9 to 11. You will hear from interesting guests, Wednesday's Word, and topics and subjects that impact our beloved community.
And don't forget about me, Devon Jones, DJ The Protege, here every Friday, bringing you Free Flow Friday, Politics Nation, Sports, Haters Nation, local events, national events. And remember, while I'm here, there'll be no passes given.
That's Community Voice, heard on The Voice, WNOV 860 106.5.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
EPMD is a world premiere for some house. EPMD is a world premiere for some house. EPMD is a world premiere for some house. EPMD is a world premiere.
Now, back to Say Something Real with your host, Michelle Bryant on WNOV.
And this is why they pay you the big bucks.
Where?
Okay. Well, this is why you deserve the big bucks. That was an amazing transition. All right, folks, only got a couple minutes left. Talking to Mr. James Matthew, Jim, to some folks, talking about housing. Before we went to break, we had brought up new senior services. And you said something about home repair?
Thank you, Michelle. I wanted to cover this quick for your listeners. So one of the problems with some of our federal funding is we cannot help City of Milwaukee residents because the City of Milwaukee gets their own federal funds. So okay. HUD will only let us serve suburban communities with some of our funds. So we do emergency home repairs for our suburban residents through our HUD funding, anybody that needs furnaces, electrical, those different types of things that can't afford it. We always were getting calls from people at the City of Milwaukee that were residents of the city, particularly seniors, asking for our help, and we didn't have the funds to help them.
Okay.
So what the county executive did through the budget is we took $1 million of county funds and started our first senior home repair program for City of Milwaukee residents, just for city residents.
David Crawley, look at you.
Oh, that's fantastic.
That is amazing.
Yeah, so we just started that program now. We're taking applications. So they're pouring in for sure. So these are for seniors age 62 or older that are City of Milwaukee residents and are lower income, so fixed income, those different types of things. For listeners that are interested in talking about a referral, they can contact the Aging and Disability Resource Center at 414-289-6874.
All right, so that's
414-289-6874.
Okay. And then, you know, I'm glad you mentioned that piece because it made me also think about, and I actually got some text messages about the housing authority. And, you know, somebody literally said, are you going to let him off the hook on the whole housing authority issues we're having right now? But our listeners need to understand something. Can you help us with that piece?
Sure. So a lot of folks don't know that Milwaukee County has its own housing authority. So we operate our own housing authority in Milwaukee County within housing services. So we do CDBG, we do home, we do homeless services, but also operate Milwaukee County's housing authority. So it is a completely separate housing authority than the city of Milwaukee's housing authority.
So so we want to make sure when people like Michelle, why aren't you asking certain questions? Because these are two separate entities.
They're two separate entities. Right. In our housing authority, the progress we've made on homelessness is probably because of the county's housing authority. We prioritize individuals that kind of have the most needs in our community. So for us, that's going to be homeless individuals. So we have more of a direct access to rent assistance vouchers through the county's housing authority.
So Jim, I want to say Jim. So
that's okay.
So Jim, this has been nothing short of an incredibly informative discussion this morning.
I appreciate that.
A number of people have reached out regarding contact information or to offer, express an interest about, how can they use properties that they have towards the mission. So how can people reach you
out to you? I'll throw my email address out there. It's probably the best way to start, and we can take it from there.
Okay.
So James.Mathy, that's M-A-T-H-Y, at MilwaukeeCountyWI.gov.
Say it one more time for me, James.
James.Mathy, M-A-T-H-Y, at MilwaukeeCountyWI.gov.
All right. So this question, it's not probably related. Well, it's related, but not one for you. Who has allowed hedge funds to purchase up the majority of the single family homes in America? So I will deal with that because that has certainly stood out. And then one other thing by way of an announcement real quick. I got an announcement. Free glasses at City on the Hill today. Not really a lot of people there this morning. So I will figure that out, see if I can get Keith to mention that. But free glasses. And I'm like, is that like eyeglasses? Free glasses at City on the Hill today. I wish I had known. So we got to get you back though.
Please. Anytime.
Like, we'll have your music laid out for you.
This is good. This has been fun. Appreciate it.
But this has been highly informative. And just a couple things I'm going to say on air. I shared it with you during the break. People that have texted and said, like, you can hear this dude is genuine. You can hear it through the phone. These jobs, while not always, the most lucrative, they are certainly the most rewarding.
Absolutely.
When you realize the change and the difference that you're making. And it's nothing like people who have to come in from service or come in for services, and they have to tell, you're telling people, you're coming on your worst days most often. And so to have department heads and people in these organizations that appreciate that, and that the humanity is still there, the decency is still there, the respect is still there. Like, you are, I just met you today, but you are a really great reflection of the county. And I just want to tell you how much I appreciate
you. No, thank you, Michelle. I really appreciate that. It means a lot.
It's clear. It's clear.
It means a lot.
This job is important to you. Caller, I see you, but I can't get you in. So I want to thank the folks over at Milwaukee County. I don't know what we're talking about next month, but it's going to be hard to top this conversation. And I'll reach back out. Hey, Jackie. But we'll reach out maybe in a couple months and see if we can get Jim back on some updates on some of these projects.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. All
right.
Thank you.
All right, family, I got to get out of the way. Key, I appreciate you. Young Carvey. Yes, my man. All right, family. I will talk to you all tomorrow. Peace.